We are tonight's entertainment.
You will never find the more wretched hive of scum and villainy.
Excellent!
Hello, everyone. Welcome to an episode of the Movie Mania Podcast, where we talk films past, present, and future. I am Sherman Trey White of Podcast Media, and joining me are the men, the myths, the legend. We're biding our time till Suicide Squad, Trilby and Bandit.
What? Yes, we are the podcast of 1,000 different faces, or at least upwards of 20 different faces.
Yeah, give or take. That's a very, very specific amount, Bandit. I wonder what that's all about.
Yeah. All right. How you guys been doing? You guys all right?
Yes.
Yeah, been good.
Good. Yes. Okay. Yeah, so let's just jump in. Okay, first of all, before we get into what we're getting into today, there are time codes listed below. I made sure to write that down this time because I always forget to. Time codes listed below so you can jump between the episodes. But this should be a shorter episode. It's obviously going to be like 2 hours. But it should be a shorter episode because we're not going to have a feature presentation this week.
Yes,
this week we're going to have a...
It's a mini episode. And that's not just something we made up because we couldn't think of anything to do this episode. And we're all lazy. That's actually a legit thing.
It's sort of an episode to do Harry Potter. We totally could have started Harry Potter this week, but we decided not to. I don't know why we didn't do that.
Why didn't you mention that before? We could have done that.
I completely forgot. Never mind.
Don't worry, listeners. It's just a prank. It's just a prank, bro. That means it's okay. That's like, that means everything's okay if you just say it's a prank.
We were going to do Jason Bourne and Batman the Killing Joke today, but you and I, Trey, talked about Batman the Killing Joke last week, and this week neither of you guys wanted to see Jason Bourne, so...
I saw Jason Bourne, but I mean, you know, because
I don't want to see it.
It wasn't, we couldn't talk like an hour about that anyway.
I mean, I could probably rant on it for an hour, but I won't, so.
But we should probably get into our winner for our amazing new Movie Mania podcast logo design. You guys listening to us on SoundCloud or iTunes or on the YouTube, you'll be able to see it on the screen. Here is our winner, number 12. He is... coming in with 259 votes, 22% of the vote. He is Jenk Birchill, number 12, a.k.a. Thank you so much, Jench.
Yes.
Jenk.
Great job, everybody. I
can't pronounce that. But thanks, mate. I'll email you
your
as soon as we're done recording.
Well. You're doing very well, Bandit. Good job. He just woke up, guys. Okay. It's early over there. It's like 6 o'clock.
To make everybody feel better, everyone was great and everyone's a winner. But more accurately, number 12 is the winner.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
I do need to apologize to everyone because I very stupidly, when I announced this, I didn't give a deadline.
Oh, you got hell for that.
I stupidly did not think of giving a deadline. I didn't think ahead that far. And as a result,
I was just like,
a couple of days, a couple of days in the comment section. So a couple of days later, when I was uploading the video for everyone to vote, I think about 3 or 4 submissions came in just after that, which I weren't able to enter. And I'm so sorry, guys, because some of them were really good. The last one that just came in even had the Kurt Russell planet being orbited by the Arnold Schwarzenegger planet in the background.
Oh, no!
I know.
What?
I know.
Put
we were talking about that last week.
At least.
I know.
Just put them on the Movie Mania Facebook page.
Yeah. Look, so I'm so sorry to those guys, but we are going to be buying more than one logo, so don't worry. So even if you didn't win first place, you might be getting contacted from us anyway, and we figured... unless anyone has any objections with us using their logo, we'll do a victory lap. While on the Facebook and the Twitter pages, we'll have our official winner here, number 12. Each week we'll cycle through each of the pictures so we can show everyone's, because they were so good. There was so much creativity there.
Might I jump in by adding the fact that the winner of this week, if you're probably thinking, but if there's 26 designs, and you know, so if we cycle through every single design that we've got, including the ones that weren't entered in time, we should be through all of them by sometime next year. So thank you to the winner.
That should get us to like the end of the year, maybe into the new year.
Yeah, by like February, we should be back to the old original design that won back in August. So thank you very much, Mr. Birchill. Yes.
Yeah, but honestly, like, yeah, absolutely. There were so many ones in here that could have been, you know, first place. They were fantastic.
Yeah,
that was so great. Well, what were your favorites, guys? Like, well,
I mean, my personal.
Let's not say favorites. Let's say some standout ones for you guys.
Right. Okay. Well, some standout ones where I love.
Everyone could see the winner on their phone or on the screen right now. So let's talk about what were some of the other ones you especially liked.
A lot of people voted for number 19. I quite enjoyed that one, even though they turned Bandit into a wolf. I really liked that one. I think that was the Temple of Doom one. Yeah. I love the Mean Girls one because that's. And I love the fact that on the Magic Mike one,
yeah,
it's like they photoshopped my head onto the tannest body there. And I really appreciate it.
Yeah, the Mean Girls one, I love how I'm on Amanda Seyfried's body. It's my boobs that tell the future.
I was worried with that Mean Girls because I laughed my ass off so much watching that. But then I thought, oh God, no, everyone's going to vote for that just because it's funny and we're going to be stuck with
that's
this,
what I thought,
with all three of us in drag forever. But thankfully, not.
I was thankfully, like, we got some really incredible submissions, so people didn't vote for that one.
But my girlfriend's favorite was number one. It was the Back to the Future Part 3 one. Yeah. Not just because I was the damsel in distress, what's her name, from that film who everyone hates, but mainly because the faces that were put on top of those characters, like, perfectly blended in. They were the perfect faces and the perfect poses. So it was quite a seamless Photoshop job. So that one was really funny.
Yeah.
I also really love the Reservoir Dogs one. The one that's like that scene from Reservoir Dogs. They lift up the trunk. Mr. Blotner reveals that he has the cop's body in the trunk, and I love the fact. I'm pretty sure I'm Mr. Pink, so he's my favorite character from that movie. So yay, yeah. I love some really great submissions here, guys. I also love the at the movies like kind of style one, like the really movie cool. Maniacs one of us in the theater. I love it. Kind of looks like an oil painting almost. It looked really well done. There are some really great ones there, guys. Yeah.
There's a cool one where we kind of look. I think it's weird that I was portrayed as a Ghostbuster in many of them.
Yeah,
it was either Ghostbuster or
because
or
of
the
your
doctor,
vigorous
yeah.
defense of the remake, you're a Ghostbuster in a lot of them.
Yeah, in one of them, I have a sonic screwdriver from Doctor Who. Only one of them, and in like three or four of them, I'm a Ghostbuster. But there was a funny one where I've got a proton pack and everything in the background, and I've got just this weird, innocent, gormless, fat face. I think I can't remember what number that one is, though. I think it's number 12.
Oh, yeah.
Which one?
I know the one you mean where all of us have like. It really puts the manic in the mania bit. Head is like half of the size of the screen. And we're all like, wah! That was fantastic. Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, there is.
That's a funny one.
There's another one that was like Ren and Stimpy style, where it was like three of us, and our heads were like all weird and fantastic.
Yes, Ren and Stimpy, like Terry, like Fury and Loathing in Las Vegas, like warped faces. That one really a lot of effort into that. Also, to those who were, you know, who were respectably enough salty that that the deadline was so short. That does not mean that we will not look at your, because we've been getting fan submitted things long before, you know, this contest was ever a thing. And don't think that just because, and I think I commented this on the picture on the video, don't think that just because the contest is closed and the quote unquote prize is gone ish. don't think that you just can't, we don't look at all the stuff that you guys send us. We love everything we get from you guys, whether it be a Photoshop or a meme or one of my favorite ones is someone about the Ghostbusters reboot. Yeah, you guys always do great things, and thank you very much for that.
So I would like to buy every one of them, but I can't afford to.
Just a couple more honorable mentions. There's one where I'm looking at it on the Facebook page right now, so I don't know who did it, but it's basically just the reference photos that you put in the video, Bandit, and we've got top hats, stick figure bodies, holding bags of cash with cameras, and we're just shouting Movie Mania Podcast in a speech bubble. And we've got gold chains, and Trey has got the biggest gold chain.
Of course. Absolutely. You sound surprised.
It's such random stuff. But there's another one which once again uses the reference photo, I think, and it's just Trey's got a tie, 3D glasses. I have a weird smudge on my face. I don't know. A lot of effort. A lot of thought.
There was one where it was like the Death Star as like one of the film clappers that had Movie Mania on it, and Bandai I think had a laser, and Chobi had I was Kylo Ren, and there are some really great ones here, guys. Yeah.
We got to one of them was like hand drawn on a bit of paper, and like he had to scan it, so he had to take a photo. That one got in just under the wire, made it into the video. Really good representation of like the lethal weapons, where it's like got me as Mel Gibson, you Trey as whatever that actor's name is, and Trilby, you're the guy sort of peeking over the shoulder, like you know in that Lethal Weapon poster.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's one. Oh yeah, we're Riggs and Murtaugh.
There's one that was like little pixelized, sort of like the IT crowd. One, there's so many.
Oh yeah,
great ones.
I like that one.
So many great
but
ones. Yeah.
I do have to. This is pure vanity, by the way. But I do take umbrage with you, Bandit, using a photo from the Christmas Detectives where it's a deliberately awkward face, and that is the reference photo everybody went with.
Like,
where
three like, chins.
I've got three chins. I've got a stupid fringe, a flicky fringe. Oh, I have a stubble. I've got a 5 o'clock shadow or whatever. And that's the photo that everyone went by.
I'm going to send you guys.
I should have found.
I think I've actually.
Should have found
I found the one that I think I like.
Picture from like in the early days of your channel or something? Is that what you would have liked?
Maybe, but if can I personally pay the winner $50 again just to liposuction my face? Just for that one. It's pure vanity reason. The artwork was accurate and awesome and stuff. It's because pure vanity, I'll admit.
You got the magic mic one there. You can always look at that.
I did.
That one's my favorite, guys. I love the way I look in that picture. I'm not going to tell you which one it is, audience, but I just sent it to them. That one right there, guys. That is my favorite. I love the crazed look in my face to that one.
He is looking right at me. Just
like, what are you doing here?
And Bandit's like, where am I? All I see are rainbows.
Oh my god. This is a good
lot of good stuff on display. And one of my personal favorites is when I'm literally just a Trilby on legs.
Yeah,
and it's like my book cover is on top of the Trilby. I'm just a hat on legs.
So thanks much, guys. We got I got the results here. There was 1,161 votes in the end. On this poll. And it ended up between the top three. It was 22% for the winner, 21%, and then 20%. So it was very close. It was only like 10 votes between each of the top three.
It was like a three-way Brexit, really, wasn't it? It was really close.
Yeah.
But there can be only one winner.
It was always close, but number 12, our winner, he was like... he was on the front from the very beginning, and like you know, the two sort of edged closer and would sometimes overtake each other. But number 12, the one everyone's seeing now, this one was always in front though. So great job, mate!
This
fantastic.
One is a good one, yeah. Yeah. Oh man, I'm so happy that we have fans that can do this kind of thing. That's awesome. All right.
And I'm glad it wasn't up to us to pick a winner. It was up to the audience. That way none of us look like jerks for picking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone can be a jerk together.
You're the terrible people.
Y'all people are the ones that suck. We're fine. We just did what you guys said. Yeah. Star Wars was the best movie last year.
You are our suicide squad. You're the patsies. We have zero accountability.
But I do know that each of us individually voted for our favorites, of course, and each of us just voted for whichever one made us look the best. So
that's not inherently true.
So we all voted Magic Mike. No, we didn't.
I voted for Mean Girls.
Well, speak for yourself.
Yeah. All right.
Do you think we would have gotten sued for having Magic Mike as our poster, like as our logo? It's like, oh no, this is just ours. After taking the Magic Mike,
they're like, yeah, that's actually
that's going on my wall. It's going to be right next to the front door. So when guests walk in, they'll be like, "What's that?" I'm like, "Oh yeah, that's when I was in the stage production of Magic Mike." Why is one of them a cat?
Yeah, so starting next week, we'll cycle through all of them. I'll actually start with some of the ones that came in just a bit too late, because there was a really good anime one as well. I'll put that one up.
Oh God, I'm in tears.
Actually, next week I'll put in the one with the Kurt Russell planet and the Schwarzenegger moon in the background.
Please.
And then after that, I'll put in the anime one and I'll work my way back. So there we go. So everyone will get a shot.
Yeah. All right. So that being said, guys, let's get to the little movie news that we have here.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? I've just been handed an urgent and horrifying news story. Cannonball!
All right, guys, so this is the movie news, and this is the movie news where we talk about some of the news that happened in the last week. Not a lot. The week after Comic-Con is usually kind of a lull in terms of movie news. We have a couple of things here. Did you guys see the new Superman outfit that came out for the promo for Supergirl?
For the TV.
Yes. Have you guys seen that picture?
That looked okay.
Not really.
You haven't seen it, Brandon? Okay.
I saw the thumbnail in the video. I didn't bother clicking on the video.
Yes, I just wanted to briefly touch on that because I felt I did not like it. What did you think about that picture, Trilby?
It was basically Superman on TV. It's not an awesome, glossy, expensive outfit. It's basically the Superman outfit, but on a lower budget. It looks like Superman cosplay, but... I'm not really invested in Supergirl, so it's not something that is really taking up much headspace, to be honest. I don't have much space in my head anyway, but Superman's not really up there.
Yeah.
Yeah, when I saw the picture, my first thought was like, oh, is that show still going on? I was like, oh, the show's still around. Okay.
Still kicking that Supergirl, huh? They moved it to the CW because CBS wasn't going to pay for it anymore. I mean... The Superman outfit I thought it kind of looked worse than cosplay, because I've seen some really great Superman cosplay. It's like when that picture of Apocalypse came out last year, and we were talking about it, and we said that there were some actual Apocalypse cosplays that look great, that look far better than what we got in the actual movie. So I feel like they should have tried harder, but I just wanted to point that out, that Supergirl still sucks. Okay, so that's the only reason I brought that up. All right, so next story here. M. Night Shyamalan, we all know him. Some love him, some most despise him. He's the man that created The Sixth Sense, a movie Bandit still has to see, unless he hasn't seen it yet. Have you seen it?
I've got it on my homework list, but I haven't seen it yet.
All right. Well, he's done Sixth Sense, Unbreakable, Signs, really only his good movies. He did a lot of crap, and then he did The Last Airbender, which in my opinion is the second worst movie of all time. And then he did The Visit last year, which I actually quite enjoyed. If you guys haven't seen The Visit, it's a found footage horror movie, but it's quite enjoyable. Trilby's vomiting in the sea.
From what I hear about The Visit, and by what I hear, I mean from Jeremy Jansen's review, is it feels like this is M. Night Shyamalan trying to claw his way back and seemingly doing pretty good. It's like he's starting from the ground level, building everything back up again.
Well, that's essentially what he started with. When he did Sixth Sense, he was just a guy making movies. And by the time he got to The Village, he was like, you know, he was tugging himself off in his own movies. He was fellatiating himself during his movies.
Yeah.
And he got up himself so much, he got so into his ego that his movies started turning trash. Lady in the Water. But yeah,
Lady in the Water, he literally fed a film critic to a monster demon, and only he could save the world in that film.
Yeah,
that's basically the plot of Lady in the Water.
His writing is so beautiful, it will cure the world.
It will save the world.
He cast himself as that president.
He ran to Disney and made it himself. I'm sorry? Go ahead, Shelby.
The visit wasn't that bad, actually. I think I gave it like 3 stars on my website, I think. And it's because it's more of a mockumentary than it is a found footage horror film. And it actually works better as a fake documentary than it does as an actual horror film. And as a black comedy, there are some pretty funny moments in that. And I do enjoy, I remember having a good time watching it.
Well, Shyamalan, I think he finally wisened up, because from what I hear from people that have spoken to him, he's a very sweet, very nice guy. And so it's weird when you watch his movies, you're just like, where does your mind go? And so, and I feel like with The Visit, he took that kind of awkward humor, awkwardness that all his movies always kind of have, and sometimes they work better than others. Like, he took like the unintentional comedy that his movies can get, and he used that to his advantage. And but I feel like that's what he's also trying to go for in this new movie that he's doing called Split, which had the trailer come out this past week. What do you guys think about that?
Well, you just watched it before recording, and I'm glad you did, because wow, it looks really cool. It looks like Shyamalan is coming back. And the good Shyamalan, not the terrible one.
Yeah, the good Shyamalan, I mean, I'm still a little trepidatious because, to be fair, I'm pretty sure The Last Airbender had some really cool trailers. But I'm just, and The Happening had a pretty cool trailer. but it does look like a step in the right direction. What do you think, Toby?
Yeah. Professor X in drag? I mean, what more do you want?
Professor X as a 7-year-old boy? Yeah. All in the same movie.
Talk about what you doing, eh? That's how he talks.
You said when you were reacting to the trailer, Vander, that it reminded you of 10 Cloverfield Lane, and that's the vibe I got when the trailer first started. I loved the opening hook is great. How they're in traffic, or so the car has stopped. The girls look in the driver's seat, and all of a sudden there's a stranger there who kidnaps them and takes them away. That's a great hook. And then you get James McAvoy. Has anyone seen the movie Filth?
No, I have it, I think, in my Netflix queue, so I'm going to watch it from sometime soon. Yeah,
and it's got James McAvoy as just the most abhorrent, corrupt, and terrible police officer ever in that film, doing these horrible things. And I think he's gone back into Filth territory with Split, because he's amazing in that film, and he looks like he's having so much fun here. And I think that if anything's going to derail Split, it might be the supernatural elements that are hinted at here. But just like The Visit, this is a small cast in a small, sealed-off location for the most part. And like you said, Bandit, he's building himself back up. He's not going for another huge blockbuster or another high-concept sci-fi film like Unbreakable or Signs. Right. He's going for something much smaller and building his reputation back up, and I think that's what he needs right now. And the trailer, it started well. I got more intrigued as it went along. James McAvoy looks like a lot of fun in this.
Yes, he's having so much fun.
The only thing that concerns me is the January release date.
Exactly, that's what I was going to get at. So that's I have a couple of things that make me a little nervous. Okay, so I've seen a minute and a half of that trailer, because I stopped watching it about a minute and a half in, because I paused it and I said, okay, I don't want to see anything else, because I was worried that it was going in a direction that felt like it was spoiling too much. I don't know. I stopped watching about halfway through. So, but my other concern is, yes, it comes out in January, which for the last decade or so, that has been the dumping ground of awful movies. There have been some good movies that have come out in January of the few years.
Kingsman came out in February, so you can get a few gems there.
But February, I think, is what it's. Yeah, I was going to say, Kung Fu Panda 3 came out this January, and that was a really solid movie. But I think February is where the good movies have started again, because we also got a Lego movie in February, I think, at least here in America.
Maybe he's just hedging his bets. Maybe he's like, I'm sure this is good, but let's not take any risks. Let's put out January just in case.
He's like, I'm sure this movie's awesome, but just in case everyone else thinks it sucks, bad movies.
If this movie Split turns out to be as good as the trailer makes it look, then everyone's going to go, Shyamalan is back. I don't think that's ever happened with a director before. I don't think we've ever had a director sink to that low and then actually build himself up again.
No,
it's an amazing accomplishment if it happens.
It's happened with actors before. I think John Holt has done it twice.
Yeah.
I think this would be kind of a high profile director where if he can do, I think it's going to take one more, because The Visit still wasn't universally praised. Everyone just kind of thought of that was pretty good, but it wasn't universally loved. I think it's going to take a couple of more of his movies to be either pretty good or really great for him to start getting his name put back on things. because the trailer never said from director M. Night Shyamalan, it just said from the creator of Sixth Sense and The Visit. So I think they're waiting to put his name back on things. My other concern is that the movie's going to have a twist. I don't think it needs one, because The Visit had a twist, and I won't give away what it is, but it's a twist that you can watch the trailer and say, oh, well, obviously this is the twist, in a sense. But I'm worried that this film's going to try to pull the rug from underneath us, and I don't want it to. I want it just kind of be a straightforward, black comedy thriller about people trying to escape this crazy man with 24 personalities?
23.
Yeah.
23 personalities.
Well, maybe that's the twist. It's 24 personalities.
They might be pulling a Primal. Have you guys seen Primal Evil or whatever? Primal Fear? Yeah, Primal Fear with Edward Norton. It's all about split personalities, and there's a twist in that. If you haven't seen Primal Fear, watch Primal Fear. It's really good.
You're worried it might twist, and it'll suddenly be that he's an alien, and they throw a glass of water on him, and he dies? Or like, or they'll close the door and he just can't get through the door or something like that.
Oh, Shyamalan would never do that. That's a stupid idea.
Yeah, why would they all? Why would they at all go to a planet that's 70% covered in water and then can't get through a wooden door? Nostalgia cuts review of that movie.
What if the twist is? What if the twist is like? They've written on this character's hospital records. He's got 23 personalities, and then they're looking at the hospital notes, and then somebody lifts up their thumb, and it says 230 personalities. There was a zero being covered up.
That sounds pretty cool.
And then James McAvoy really goes for that Oscar, but it's in January, so everyone forgets it by the time the next Oscars come along.
Everyone just forgets about it.
January in the UK is awesome because we get all of the Oscar holdovers in January. We get all of the great films that we've been waiting for. So there's no such thing as a January death nail of cinema thing in the UK.
Well, where I live, which I won't disclose here, is
Grace.
We don't. Yeah. Montana. No, where I live, I don't live in either LA or New York, so I don't get whenever you watch a preview on TV and it says in select theaters and such day. That usually means it comes out in LA and New York, so it can go out in time for Oscar season. But oftentimes, if a movie comes out in, I don't know, November or mid December, it won't come out till like January here in the where I'm at and nationwide across the United States. So oftentimes I'll get films like The Revenant and Hateful Eight not until January. That's neither here nor there. Split. Yeah,
come on, Trey. You know you live in my basement. And I'll just feed you. I'll feed you worms like at the end of the Babadook or something.
Oh my god. That's right. They do that.
Oh man. Okay. Where am I? What am I on about?
I don't know. You just took this podcast in a completely different location. I have no idea. All right, let's just pull it back in. All right.
Maybe I've got a split personality.
Yeah, that was evil Trilby talking.
I am James McAvoy.
I am no longer Trilby. I am Fez, you know?
I am Fedora. We're more or less the same.
Oh, my God. Reminds me of Bob Burger's Dina. Dina's my spirit animal. Anyways, okay. All right, guys, let's get to the homework.
This week, each one of you has a homework assignment. You're going to go out. You're going to start a fight with a total stranger. You're going to start a fight, and you're going to lose.
All right, so this is the homework portion of the show, in which case we talk about some of the films that we have recently seen or were assigned to see. Who wants to go first?
Can I start? Because I saw the Jason Bourne.
All right, right on. I saw it too. All
which
right.
is probably why this episode is going to be called, because I can't think of what else to call it if it's a mini-sode. But yes.
Just call it mini-sode. Just call it mini-sode.
Jason Bourne mini-sode. Well, no spoilers. Don't worry, I won't give anyone spoilers. But Jason Bourne, Matt Damon's big triumphant return to the franchise again, which turns out not really to be that triumphant. It's not terrible.
It's really boring. It's really boring.
It is. It's boring.
I was having trouble falling asleep. I don't nod off in the theater often, but sorry, you go on ahead.
Oh, that's right. Sorry, because you saw it too. Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm the one who skipped it because I have no interest in this franchise. Really, yeah. I don't like any of them. I don't hate them. They've been so average. And I have no inclination to see Jason Bourne because it just looks like more of that.
Well, the previous ones, the Matt Damon ones, not the spin-off one that no one wants to mention, but the previous ones,
I like that one.
Like the appeal is cool car chase, cool hand-to-hand fighting, but then there's that human connection of he's trying to get his life back. This doesn't have that third thing. It doesn't really have Jason Bourne getting his life together. Like it is straight up pretty much like a copy and paste job of the previous scripts, but it just doesn't work in the same way. And it's like, ugh. Like it's Jeremy Jans again in his review. He talked about, you know, this movie always has like a grumpy old white guy in a suit. This time we got a grumpy old white guy in a suit. We got like an ambitious CIA lady who's like, I'm going to get Jason Bourne because of this misunderstanding. I think he's the bad guy, but I'm sure he'll turn out not to be the bad guy. And it's, ugh. There's like an evil Russian.
It really is the first movie.
Evil Russian spy going after him. It's like all of the same stuff again. They could have just done like a search and replace for the names in the scripts It's like, come on. Yes. Come on.
It was essentially the first. It was because I've seen one and I've seen four. Now, four being the Jeremy Renner one, which I quite enjoy. I think that's because it was the first one I saw. But I saw one last week, and I was so blown away by just how they were able to do the hand-to-hand fighting and have me able to actually still pay attention and understand what's going on. Mm. But, you know, that being said, hey. This movie, I turned to the person I saw it with, and I said very quickly, I said, I'm getting very, very bored of watching Matt Damon sulk around a foreign city with intense music playing in the background. Like, he'll cross the street and it'll just be... Like, it's just that for, like, 40 minutes, and it's really boring. You know, some of the stuff you see in the trailer is not in the movie, or if it is in the movie, it's shown from a different, poor angle. Alicia Vikander's in it, who you'd probably know from Ex Machina. She's in it. Excuse me. She's okay. She does her best, I guess, but she just kind of stares around and looks sad the whole time. Tommy Lee Jones is Tommy Lee Jones, but everything just feels so one note. It feels so one dimensional. Nothing ever really pops movie wise. Yeah.
And I found that as well. Like, I'm sitting there and I'm like, it must be getting close to the end. And I look at my watch and it's been like 45 minutes.
Yeah.
It's and I was like, you know, and when that happens, you find yourself thinking stuff that you shouldn't normally think in these movies. Like,
exactly.
It's got the scene where the guy's talking to Tommy Lee Jones on the phone, like sort of his second in command, Tommy Lee Jones, second in command, and he's like walking through the halls of like the Pentagon or wherever talking, and I'm thinking, you know, I wonder if they really do talk openly on the phone through the hallways of the Pentagon like that. Because people could still hear you on the phone. You know, he's like,
oh, yeah, like
Jason
someone's...
Bourne has blown up a city. And it's like, well, yeah, people could hear, but I'm thinking,
they'll be sitting in a diner and they'll be having a conversation and they'll just like stop. And then someone will walk by and they'll just keep talking. I'm like, no, people probably heard you before they walked up to you.
Yeah.
But I do think this movie does have some...
It's that Indian Steve Jobs guy. Hey, we love you.
Yes.
And everyone would stop and get a picture, and Tommy Lee Jones would be like,
"This movie, I completely forgot that social media aspect was in the movie for a second.
Me too.
But I really, this movie has, I think, one really... I think, well-done scene. Maybe it's because I haven't seen the second or third movie, but there's a bit in the middle where they're thinking that they're going to try to find Bourne, and they're going to... And, yeah, when Bourne assembles a meeting with a certain character, and it all kind of converges in the center, I thought that was really well done. And I think that's when kind of the table flips and things are revealed and everyone's character motivation is kind of already set. And I thought that was a cool bit.
See, Jason Bourne's doing his stuff, it's interesting. You know?
Yeah. Like, whenever that scene was over, I was like, oh, finally. Oh, my God, I'm coughing. I was like, oh, finally, we're finally getting to this. We're finally getting to the best part of the movie. The movie's finally going to start picking up, and then just stops again. And just a little... Even the ending itself, I'm like, okay. Like, the movie ends, and it's just like, I don't know. Like, it does that cheesy thing where it pans up to a city and then goes to black. It's like,
Well, I think... It's just The Russian spy that's going after him, or he could have been, I don't know, just Eastern European or whatever, but that guy is going after him. They give him a backstory early on in the movie, which they kind of ruin with another twist later on in the movie. But they gave him a backstory where I thought, that's actually really good. So it's not a spoiler for me to say, because they have twists and stuff later that sort of override it. But they say the backstory is that when Jason Bourne, in the previous movies, went after Trent Stone, which is the organization that sort of... created him, basically.
Mm-hmm.
When he went after them to get revenge and burn the whole organization down, in the process some of those spies had their identity revealed. So the spy that is sort of going after Bourne here is one of those spies that had his identity revealed, and he got captured and he was tortured for a few years until he finally escaped. So that's why he's got a vendetta against Bourne now, because he blames him for that. And I thought, that's actually really interesting. I thought, can we just get a movie of just spy versus spy, where Jason Bourne, he's a guy that he inadvertently, you know, uncovered his identity, and now this guy is going after Bourne with the same kind of intensity that Bourne went after Trent Stone in the previous movies? I'll be like, that, I want to see that. I was like, that'd be
a
cool
movie where Bourne is kind of the villain of the film, where Bourne is hiding out and the spy is now hunting
because
him.
Because the Bourne movies are always about him facing the ghosts of his past, so this would be a ghost of his past, and I thought that'd be cool.
Yeah.
Like, they can make, like, the other spy is also sort of, he's, like, gone rogue and he's off the grid just like Bourne is. So he could be like, you know, the exact, like, the equivalent of Bourne. I was like, that'd be really cool. I want to see that. But then they don't really.
Do you think this movie could have been better?
And reveal stuff about Bourne and his dad. And I'm like, I don't care. It's not interesting.
Do you think it could have been better if instead of the Russian guy, they made that character Jeremy Renner's character from the fourth Bourne movie? Did you see that one? The one with Jeremy Renner?
Yeah, I saw that one. Yeah.
I think if they would have made that Russian guy Jeremy Renner's character, I think I think it would have helped link the two characters. I also think it would have helped it definitely would have helped add to the movie, because Jeremy Renner has that kind of charisma that when he's in a movie. Because the Russian guy is just kind of the generic Russian guy who always is kind of, you know, he goes rogue.
They didn't change up the formula enough. For, like, Matt Damon's return to the franchise, they should have changed up the formula a bit. Like, even if the spy that's going after him, they could have made it a lady spy. Because I'd be interested to see, like, how a female spy uses different tactics, kind of like Catwoman in The Dark Knight. You know how when the cops bust in, she plays the, I'm a hysterical woman.
Damsel in distress, just to get out, yeah.
You could show, like, how a female spy could use stuff like that and different tactics. Like, that could have been interesting. But no, they just went with generic spy again. Russian dude.
Yeah. All right, well, okay. What do you give it out of 10, Ben, since we're not going to talk about the movie anymore?
I'd probably give it just, like, six. I'd probably give it a 5. It was really
boring. I'll go 5.5. It really, like, I went and saw it at this really nice theater where, you know, they came out and they gave you food for it and everything, and I was still bored out of my mind.
Yeah.
Like, it got to a point to where I was just like, oh man, I'm not having a good time. I don't know. I hate watching boring movies, because that's when you kind of know you're watching, like, a bad movie. You can't really know it's bad until you, like, I don't really know it's a bad movie until after it's over. I'm like, man, that really sucked. But a boring movie, you're sitting there and just the minutes go by like hours sometimes. And okay.
And it's like when you're sitting in a movie and you're asking those questions, like, do they really have those conversations on the phone? Or like when Bourne meets up with the contact in the middle of a protest and the protest goes bad, but no one ever, like, they're sort of in a bubble. No one ever affects them or whatever. And you're kind of going, you know,
he steals someone's Molotov cocktail and no one ever just kind of fights him for it.
The guy will be like, hey, you know, or like even when he's beating up cops in the riot, you don't hear the other people in the riot going, yeah, get the pigs, like they would.
Or the other cops run to this, like, obviously strong guy that's fighting
Or like, you know, the person he's talking to is this good looking blonde chick and she's walking around alone amongst all these rioters. I'm like, would she really get through the crowd without anyone going, hey, baby? You know, I'm sure that would probably happen. It's like, you're thinking about stuff like that rather than the movie, you know, it hasn't sucked you in emotionally.
Yes, that's exactly what I'm going at here. Okay, so sorry, Chilby. How about the
It's just so interesting hearing you talk about this movie and saying basically what I have been saying for the past decade about these films. It's really interesting. One.
Okay,
the first one's the best, but that's because they have a director who knows what a tripod is. I think Paul Greengrass is a good storyteller, but just, you don't need the shaky cam. You don't.
It works in this movie.
Yeah,
I think the action's the best. Like the fight at the end with the Russian spy, which is not a spoiler. It's an action movie. You're gonna have a fight at the end. The fight at the end is, I thought, was really great. And like, it's shaky, but you can still see what's happening. It's kind of like Kingsman in that way, or just less glossy. Like someone gets punched in their head, gets punched in the wall, then like flipped into the ground, and you can kind of see that happen the whole time.
I love Matt Damon as like a charming character actor and stuff, but I don't ever believe him as an action star. Like, I think he's great in the Ocean's movies. I think he should have won the Oscar last year for The Martian.
He's pretty cut in this. He's been doing push-ups, I'll tell you.
And like, I guess what punching these guys in Fight Club style arenas, like, it's one punch and he's down. He's gone one punch man.
Yeah,
that's not in the movie.
That's not in the movie.
Well, that was the
money shot in like three or four of the trailers.
That scene put but he hits him and you don't really actually see the punch as well as you do in the trailer.
No, it's shot with, quote unquote, without a tripod. Okay, Chilby, have you seen The Adjustment Bureau, that Matt Damon movie?
I've seen bits of it. I want to watch it because I hear it's actually not just an action film. It's like a really interesting love story.
I love
that's
that
what
movie.
I've heard.
It is a potentially love story. I watched it on cable for the first time and I fell in love with that movie. It's one of my favorites.
When you walk through a door.
Have you seen the Adjustment Bureau bit?
Yeah, I've seen it. Not bad.
Oh boy. All right. Never mind then. Man's gonna go and crap on my dreams as he always does.
No, I like it. It's a good movie. Yeah.
No, it is. I was enamored by, you know, once again, the charm of Matt Damon. Emily Blunt did some good things. It reminded me a lot of kind of like a happier version of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, kind of, in the sense of the will they, won't they kind of thing with relationships. Have you seen that movie, Eternal Sunshine, with Jim Carrey? Trilby, I'm asking you.
It is on my list to watch.
Okay, right.
I know it is. It's Charlie Kaufman, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I love his other work. That's just one I've not gotten around to watching. But speaking of Matt Damon, did anyone watch the trailer for The Great Wall this past week?
Yes, it played through Jason Bourne.
It's so funny. I'm looking at the plot synopsis and all the actors, and you've got these actors like all these Chinese big names like Andy Liu, Liu Han, Eddie Peng, Jing Chang, and all these other people. And
Matt Damon,
the only white guy in China.
I'm okay with it. I just thought
it was funny.
Well, difference being, because people are upset, but I feel like the difference being between this and something like the Ancient One, and you still there, Bandit?
Yep.
Okay, make sure. The difference between something like this and the Ancient Ones, like the Ancient One's an established character. It's clearly meant for an Asian man to take over. But this one, you can. This is an original quote unquote property where they're simply taking the thought of the Great Wall of China, and you can easily say that American guy just happens to be there. I'm okay with that.
I'm obviously gonna wait until the film comes out to reserve judgment on why he's there. I just think it like just that idea. On it without any context, which I know is not fair, but without any I just think it's funny.
You watch the trailer, it's like a bunch of Asian guys, and I know it turns the corner, and it's like Matt Damon. It's like, oh, okay,
Damon's face is on the poster. And I just thought it's funny.
Well, it's like, didn't Ridley Scott brought that up a while back? He's like, say something like that, where he's like, with his
you can't get Muhammad so and so.
That's right. Yeah, he's like, nobody would go to see that. And it's like, look, he's
nobody
right.
Went
it's
to see
true.
Exodus.
If nobody you didn't wants know Matt Damon's Christian name, Bale. A lot of people wouldn't even pay attention to this movie. That's true.
You're right, Shelby. No one saw Exodus. I saw Exodus, and I almost fell asleep. Man, it's boring.
But let's not get a massive whitewashing discussion or whatever. Like, this is not the time nor place. But I guess that was
40 minutes.
But yeah, who wants to go next?
What did you see, Shelby?
Well, I've been catching up on stuff because last week I was just a pathetic movie maniac and hadn't seen anything. But this past week I did manage to check out the Killing Joke adaptation.
Oh, yeah.
I haven't listened to the rest of last week's podcast because I left like a third of the way through. So I don't know what you folks think of it.
You only watch the podcast if you're in it?
No. I only listen to it if I'm not in the podcast. Because I don't need to listen to it. I lived it. I don't need to watch the Jason Bourne movie because that is my life. That is basically me outside of YouTube.
Just walking from place to place all the time, you know?
In a foreign city with intense music playing.
Occasionally
causing trouble in London.
You know?
Killing someone with a pen and a magazine. Yep.
Yeah, that's my story and I'm sticking to it. But anyway, for the Killing Joke, right?
Yes.
The movie's in two halves. The first 30 minutes, garbage. Complete garbage. Terrible across the board.
Yep.
Then it's this whole Batgirl prologue that has nothing to do with the Killing Joke story. It's meant to be sort of like, oh, this is what happens when a crime fighter gets personal with the criminal and that. But it's so surface and it's so tacked on and lazy. It just feels like they recorded the Killing Joke normally. Tara Strong voices Batgirl, and they thought, okay, Tara's said all of her lines. We've got the studio booked for another 6 hours. Do you want to?
Yeah.
Tara, do you want to just improvise and we'll literally just animate around you? Like, it feels like that. It's so half-assed and you're so lacking in thought. And basically, I don't want to come across as a crazy feminazi or an SJW or whatever. But basically every scene in the prologue of the Killing Joke basically ends with, women, am I right?
Like, stupid like man hater.
No, but basically every single like Batgirl makes terrible mistakes that are completely out of a like out of character, basically. Yeah. And then Batman just looks at the camera and is like, yeah, this is women, am I right? It's basically at the end of every scene in the prologue of The Killing Joke. But then once The Killing Joke actually starts properly, like half an hour in, it's a solid adaptation. I think that the graphic novel does hold up. I gave it a read recently, and
weird Joker dance routine.
Hey, really? Hold up. No, like, it's not all solid gold. I think it works more thematically than it does as a concrete story. It's just the idea of the Joker doing one last gag, because it is sort of, apart with the exception of Barbara Gordon getting paralyzed. Spoiler warning for a 20-year-old comic. It's that nothing in this story stayed canon. It is like an Elseworld story. It's an alternative potential ending to the Batman and the Joker's relationship. And in that regard, I think it's a great exploration, because the most important line in the story is when the Joker says, if I'm going to have a past, I prefer it to be multiple choice.
Yeah.
And the movie depicts one of those choices that he seems to hallucinate every so often. It's like in The Dark Knight when he comes up with a new backstory every time he's threatening somebody. And that's such a clever idea for the character. Mm-hmm. And it's the ending still works incredibly well, although it's sort of that moment in when you read in the comic and you think, wait, if the Joker's trying to send a message to Batman, why is he sending henchmen to try and kill him? Surely the Batman needs to learn the lesson first before the Joker tries to kill him. Didn't make a lot of sense there.
Yeah.
But it still goes to those dark places. Like the stuff that he does to try and drive Gordon mad that's dark stuff. Like it is really dark, and it still has an impact in this animated form. Mark Hamill's terrific. Kevin Conroy's great. Tara Strong, Ray Wise as Gordon's really good. It all comes together, but I do think it should have been a bit better. I think the art style, it does feel direct-to-video. I think that
that's one of my biggest problems with it. It looked really cheap in some of the animation style.
Yes. Some moments looked great. Some moments did look cheap, but it never found a consistent feel. And as much as I love Mark Hamill, I do think that the direction he was given for the like last 5 minutes, a lot of it was just more screamy shouty than actual contemplation. Like the "why aren't you laughing" line in the comic, it doesn't have to be like line for line and perfectly adapting the graphic novel, but that frame in the graphic novel when he says "why aren't you laughing" is basically just the Joker has a human face during that moment, and he's genuinely asking why is he the only person to see this, why is he alone.
That last week
we brought this up last week.
Trey said it was supposed to be like a flashback to like when he was a comedian and no one would laugh, where he's like, why aren't you laughing?
That's what I looked at it as.
It's like, whereas in this, it's just, why aren't you laughing? And he's hitting him with a chair.
I hate that Batman laugh so much.
Batman just shouldn't laugh. And the ambiguity of the ending, because the spoiler warning, I guess, for a 20-year-old comic, the graphic novel, the ambiguous ending really works because it utilizes the medium of drawings and of comic books, but because you don't really you see the laughter stop in the comics, and that's kind of it, and you just have to think, wait, did they just have a laugh, or did Batman actually kill the Joker in that moment? Whereas in this, you just hear the laughter stop, it rains a bit, credits roll. The ambiguous ending doesn't reflect in this version, and I don't know. It's tough to explain.
Here's and my question to you too. What is it? Because I've read reviews now, and I feel like we have all said the same. Everyone has said the same thing. We were so anticipating this. We were all very excited to see how this was going to turn out. The thought of The Killing Joke with Mark Hamill and Kevin Conroy. So my question is, what exactly were you guys expecting when you walked in, or when you started watching it? What were your expectations? What were you thinking the movie was going to be?
I was thinking something more akin to like the for the art style, sort of the more 90s noir feel, as opposed to clean cut 90s animated series. Like, I was expecting something a bit more like that, and I was expecting something maybe a bit quieter. I don't know, just something a bit more contemplative, as opposed to, Batman's just going to be fighting little people and the lady with two heads. And
and he's going to throw a dwarf into a pit of spikes. So
yeah.
Murder Batman, man, he's back. He became Ben Affleck for a second there.
Yeah, I was saying he went Ben Affleck there. Never go Ben Affleck.
Never go full Affleck.
Never go full Affleck. No, but I think because they did such a good job, I think, with the Dark Knight Returns comic, when they adapted that to the big screen, I thought, man, you know, they did the character stuff, the Joker stuff, Superman stuff, the fighting, the action. It was all so well done. You know, that they've adapted the stories really well before. And so I guess when they said that they're doing the Killing Joke, because, and we should probably move on soon because we talked about this a lot last week, but when they said that they were doing the Killing Joke, I thought I was going to get the Killing Joke, and we kind of did. I thought we got Diet. Yeah, I was going to say, we got Diet Killing Joke. It's like, there's that aftertaste is really getting to me.
Yeah. And we were talking as well about, like, a little bit like with our Batman v Superman, we're like, it's kind of a shame because now it's done. We can't get the Killing Joke again in any form after this.
Yeah.
At least not for a really long time. Like the Batman versus Superman fight. We can't get that again now. Because I was saying, maybe we can get like a Ben Affleck, Jared Leto. They can work in some of the themes. And Trey's like, well, they already did that in The Dark Knight as well. So, yeah, I guess we won't ever get the...
Just swap out Barbara Gordon for Rachel Dawes, essentially. And he did The Dark Knight.
Yeah.
He did Killing... Yeah. So
it really did, yeah.
Yeah, so, okay.
And swap out Commissioner Gordon for Two-Face. Yeah.
Exactly.
I am glad that Kevin Conroy and Mark Hamill did get their chance to take their stab at the material, though, because Mark Hamill, he's been flirting with retiring from the character for years. Like, Arkham Asylum was meant to be his final appearance as the character. Arkham City was meant to be his final appearance. And so he keeps on doing this. And then he said, okay, when I do properly retire, I will only come back for the Killing Joke. And he said that like 5 years ago. And then there was fan petitions. There was all of this and that. And I'm glad that finally made it through to the finish line. I just wish that, I don't know, like,
he didn't limp his way through it. Yeah, it's like
he tried. I think it was the direction, because we know for a fact that Mark Hamill can go to those dark places as the character. If you've played Arkham Asylum,
he went to a dark place when he shoved his ass in that short guy's face. Did you guys see that on Twitter?
What? Mark Hamill of the Joker?
Yeah,
excuse me.
It was at the end of like a Star Wars panel, and everyone walked off. And Mark Hamill, he walks back out and he gets a big round of applause. And still on the stage is that little guy who, you know, he was in Ewok, he was in Willow.
He put his butt in Warwick Davis's face?
Yeah, Warwick Davis. And he walks up to Warwick. He walks back out and everyone's like, yay! And Warwick Davis goes to walk away and he kind of stops him. And he turns around and he puts his back to that guy and he does like this long, deep bow, essentially shoving his ass right in his face.
That guy's living the dream, I guess.
And I was like, oh, that's really mean. So, yeah, he went to a dark place when he did that too. So, there you go.
But yeah, because one of the...
He's like, you want to see the best, dark side of the Force? It's right here.
But... Yeah, Mark Hamill's an amazing Joker.
Search like that online, it's hilarious.
Do it.
There's a great moment in Arkham Asylum near the end when he's trying to convince Batman to take this serum to turn him into this weird hulking creature thing, and he's like, "I just want you to see the world as I see it, giggling and bleeding in a corner." And it's like, what? And Mark Hamill delivers the line so brilliantly. But he's been a fantastic Joker. And if this is his swan song, then he has nothing more to prove, really. He is amazing. And now he's Luke Skywalker again. So his career just comes full circle.
Yeah.
But speaking of Star Wars awkward stuff at panels, I won't spoil anything. I'm not going to spoil anything, but there was a Rogue One panel.
Yes.
There was a Rogue One as well. Oh, okay, fair enough. But yeah, I watched the clip, and thankfully it was somebody recorded it on YouTube, but they muted the audio so that you couldn't hear what the spoiler was. And just watching Alan Tudyk react as the guy next to him inadvertently gives a major spoiler for Rogue One away, and Alan Tudyk just sort of curls up into a ball and just wants to no longer exist.
That's a Star Wars contract burned in the ash. Yeah.
Yeah, that guy will never work again.
Yeah, no, that Disney contract is gone. There's no Rogue 2 anymore. Yeah, that's all over.
Because he just says it. Like, I won't say it in case anyone hasn't said it, but he's just like, "In my character, then this happens," and there's this big reveal, and it's like
this guy dies for this guy. And I was like, why would you... What do you want? Like, and I didn't even watch
someone
the video.
Someone else on the panel is like, maybe you should stop talking.
Yes, I read it as the title of an article. Like, I looked up Rogue One panel because I wanted to know if they gave any footage, and one of the titles was such and such and such and such dies thanks to this person. And I was like, why would you do that, guys? Why would you yell that in the... Oh, it wasn't comic book cast, in case you're wondering, but whatever. So, yeah, but that's neither here nor there. We can get him on the show if you want, Bandit. I'll keep my prejudice aside. Did you guys see anything else this week?
Actually, before we move on, speaking of which, you did mention next week someone on the show.
Oh, do you want me to mention that on the show?
Well,
Jason Bourne.
May as well. Matt Damon.
We're getting an Academy
up.
Award nominee actor. I'll say Matt Damon.
Mark Hamill.
No, we've got, I guess if Batman wants me to, the podcast won't be out until, I guess, Tuesday, America time, because we're going to be recording it on Monday, the 8th of August, or 7th of August, one of the two. Yeah, the 8th of August. That Monday, next month, the Monday after Suicide Squad comes out, talking Suicide Squad with Miss Alicia Malone.
Yay.
She will be here next. Yes. What? Yeah. All right. So, did you guys see anything else this week?
Saw the BFG.
Yep. I saw
or
it
the Bufka,
too.
As I like to call it, the Bufka.
Yeah. Were you as bored by it as I was?
Oh, thank God.
I wasn't bored, but I didn't love it. I wanted to love it because it was one of the most anticipated films of the year because I love the BFG story. I love the book. I love Roald Dahl. I love Spielberg. I love Mark Rylance. And it was a fun, fluffy, whimsical fairy tale with zero edge.
Yeah.
And Roald Dahl is all edge. He is a dodecahedron. That's like a 14-sided shape, I think. He is all edge. He is not circular, if that makes sense. Because I think the moment that really sums this up is the... It's early on in the film, but it's when the BFG, Big Friendly Giant, has kidnapped Sophie, taken her in the middle of the night and taken her to Giant Country. And it turns out that the BFG is like the runt of all of the giants. He's like half the size of the rest of them. He's like more like a quarter of the size. And then one of the big giants
really
comes
big.
In.
They are massive.
And one of the big giants comes in. And in the book, what happens is that Sophie hides inside one of the vegetables that the BFG eats, the snozcumber. And then in the book, the BFG doesn't realize that she's in there. And then the giant starts eating the snozcumber. And it's like, oh my God, Sophie is dead and being eaten at the moment. And the BFG has no idea. But whereas in the film, there's no threat. There was no danger of her ever getting eaten. It's all fine, whatever. And obviously, like I've said before, it doesn't need to be a perfect adaptation, but when you have zero edge, it's like when the BFG is getting bullied by the giants and he's just getting thrown about. There's no injury. He's a prop. He's just getting thrown about. He's being thrown down a hill. He's being put on a van and he's being hurled down a hill. And there's no threat or tension. It's all just fluff and floaty and it's all whimsy.
Yeah.
And I think the BFG...
You've got to have that threat, like, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. You do need that dark edge because it's like it's inherent in the material. Like we don't even know that the giants are eating children until way late on in the movie, whereas in the book it's early on. Like the book uses imagery saying that underneath children's windows are their bones. Their bones are in front of their bedroom windows. Whereas it's like, oh, maybe the kids are getting eaten. Maybe it's happening. We don't know. Look at us. We're popping, farting. It's kind of like that.
You reckon Spielberg's just gotten too soft as he's gotten older?
It makes sense because like when we've got Red Letter Media, where's the guy who did Jaws
where a kid gets eaten by a shark? I want that guy.
Yeah, like that legit.
I want
just
that
happens.
Spielberg again.
Because Red Letter Media summed it up perfectly when they reviewed Temple of the Crystal Skull, talking about how like maybe when Spielberg had kids, he became more conscious about the content in his films, and Indiana Jones like doesn't kill anybody in Crystal Skull, whereas in all the other ones he's killing people left, right, and center. And I think the BFG is kind of it's incredibly whimsical and fun and charming, and I enjoyed it and had a good time with it. But I think the BFG is more than just a whimsical tale. It's a dark story at points, and it does have this colorful, creative language and this really sweet relationship at its center. But there are real stakes, and they do have to save the world from these giants. Where it's like, oh, well, we've got to go stop the giants, but let's have a half hour scene of comic relief at breakfast.
It's like you feel this urgency of they got to stop the giants, and then the movie stops for like half an hour for them to have a tea party.
It's really weird. I did like the film, and I think that Mark Rylance is amazing in the role. It's basically just a perfect live action BFG character. And I think Ruby Barnhill as Sophie was really good as well. And I think the effects were great, and the sequence of them catching the dreams and them going through the lake and they're upside down. It's really creative stuff, but I do feel underwhelmed by it. Like the whimsy, no-threat tone worked for the Adventures of Tintin movie because it was all animated, it was all motion capture, and it's basically just a family-friendly adventure film based on really easygoing, matter-of-fact stories, the Tintin books. Whereas this, it's kind of trying to get rid of all of the edges from an author who is all edge. Like, it's one reason I really love the Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory film from the 60s or 70s. Yeah. It's not a great adaptation of the book, but that's dark.
Yeah.
Like, you lose.
He kicks a kid into the chocolate river. You guys, go back and watch that scene. He kicks, he gives that child a nudge, and then he's just like, no, wait, stop, please. I love that movie, though. I'm just saying, people forget that happens.
Yeah, stop, come back. Pretty dark. And it's like, I don't like this whole thing of that. Yeah, I agree with you. It's okay for there to be danger and scary things and threats in kids' movies, because like when you go back and look at like the classic fairy tales, when you read them as an adult, they're really dark. Real dark. Like Little Red Riding Hood and all this sort of stuff. It's pretty intense, actually. But I think it's important because it's like kids' movies, like they're not just something to put on that kids can watch and, you know, keeps them zombified for an hour or so. It's also a way to sort of help kids to learn not to be scared by the world as well. Yeah. That's sort of like part of it. So, yeah, I agree with you, Trilby. Like, yeah, I think Spielberg's gone a little bit soft, and by removing all the threat out of the BFG, he just kind of made this bland fluff piece.
So, guys, tell me, how does it feel to have no soul?
I do land on like defending the film in a sense, but like when I review on my site, it is going to be a positive review. But I do feel disappointed by it in a sense. I did have high hopes for it.
Yeah, because the main character is a woman, isn't it? That's why you're defending it.
listen. I don't mind if they make a Jane Bourne or whatever, or the big friendly girl, or if they make if they make a Lady Joker. As long as she's not busting ghosts, we're okay.
That's
it's
right.
Fine.
Exactly.
As long as I don't care if the Rocketeer is not going to be a black lady. She just can't have a proton pack.
I didn't make that an Easter because I really don't care. I've gotten really sick of hearing about, listen to the all-female or the race change. I'm like, just make it a good movie.
But have you heard that they're remaking The Splash, that Tom Hanks film where he falls in love with a mermaid, but they're going to gender swap it, and the mermaid is going to be played by Channing Tatum?
Oh, for God.
Why?
That news broke like 5 minutes before we started recording.
Why not just remake Splash? First of all, why remake Splash? But second of all, if you're going to remake Splash, then why not just make it a female mermaid again and just make the female a good character? I don't understand. Whatever.
See, it's just political correctness, guys.
We don't have time to get into this right now.
No, but like, hang on, could I just go back? Did you say, was that a joke that the Rocketeer is a black lady now?
No, that's happening.
That's a real thing.
It really is.
That was a news story for last week.
Yep, that's it.
Holy cow. Yeah, I saw they were remaking. I didn't bother watching, but like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, I'm all for diversity in film, but it's getting a little bit ridiculous at this point. Like, you don't need to change everything just for the sake of changing everything.
If you do, don't make it a big deal. But then again, I guess it's not the studios that are making it a big deal. It's more of the press themselves, like the news stories that... Like, I feel like it's Disney that owns The Rocketeer, doesn't it? I feel like Disney was just like,
I think so.
The Rocketeer is now we're looking for a black actress to play The Rocketeer. And then Variety was like... Oh, Disney's making a movement in progressiveness and making everything black and female. I'm like, no, they probably just wanted to, because, you know, it's Disney. They can do whatever they want. If they want to make a movie about a white guy, they will. And then they have before. I'm just, yeah, whatever. Yeah. Anyways.
Well, I mean, look,
Bandit, you're just an SQW, a status quo warrior.
I am. Status quo. I just want everything to go back to the 1950s. Yeah, it was much better.
I have some concerns with that.
No, but look,
I personally,
I think Ghostbusters has proven that, like you said, Trey, just give us a good movie. Like, you know, look, it doesn't really matter if you swap the genders or whatever. Just make a good movie. If you don't, people aren't going to... Swapping genders or swapping races isn't going to matter if you make a crap movie. So just make a good movie.
Yeah. Yeah, really. That's ultimately what life is about. Just make good movies, man.
Speaking of good movies, I did see Finding Dory.
Oh, yeah.
It finally came out in the UK. Finally?
I saw that a month and a half ago.
Yep, came out like 2 days ago in the UK.
Yeah.
You like Sigourney Weaver?
Well, I find that when that happens with kids films, it's usually because they want to release it at school holidays, and school holidays usually start at different times. It must be school holidays in England, yeah?
Yeah, it was summer holidays, so the kids get like 6 weeks off.
Yeah, yeah. Which makes sense. They want to wait until then to release it, yeah.
Yeah,
it makes sense. But yeah, okay, so Finding Dory. It ain't Finding Nemo, but it's pretty darn great.
Mm.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's better than Finding Nemo. That's just because I don't like Finding... I don't love Finding Nemo. I think it's... Yeah, heresy, I know. But it's like everyone loves that movie unabashedly, and I'm not saying that it's not a good movie. It's a very good movie. It's still in my top probably 7 Pixar movies, but this one I just don't love it. So
Wow.
Yeah. I've told you guys this before. Anyways, do you have anything to add on that, Trilby, or shall we? Or shall we go on?
Well,
it feels
Sorry, go on. No, you go.
I was just going to say, don't you think, though, it felt like it was about 20 minutes too long?
Like, I felt like,
there were so many hurdles she has to jump. At a point, you're just like, okay, can she just meet her parents, please? Can we just wrap this up? But oh no,
I like that,
now
though,
they keep going and they keep going. It's like, come on, guys.
I like that, though, because it felt like that's what she would actually go through if she was in the situation. She would have to go through constant hurdles. I was okay with the film's length,
But I think this is one of the things we talked about. The difference, though, like, they have the same thing with Finding Nemo, but the difference is they can cut back and forth between like Marlin and Nemo, and then they jump over to see what Nemo was doing. So they can switch back and forth and back and forth. But with Finding Dory, it's pretty much just Dory all the time.
No, they switch to Marlin and Nemo every so often.
That. Yeah, and every now and then, but not enough. And they weren't doing anything really interesting. So I think they needed something there to sort of break it up a bit more. Otherwise, it felt like it became a bit repetitive towards the end.
Mm. Hey, man.
Yeah, yeah. I do think it was a bit long, maybe by maybe just by 5-10 minutes. I think it was the fact that the ending was so big and drawn out. Like the biggest that Finding Nemo ever got in terms of like interacting with the world was, oh, we're going to wreck stuff in the dentist office. Whereas Finding Dory... I'm sure people died. I'm sure there were a lot of road-related deaths.
A lot of car crashes
at the end of Finding Dory.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't want to give spoilers because it's only just come out in the UK. But yeah, I'm sure that Dory is kind of going to be... She's going to be charged for manslaughter at some point. Yeah. Not murder. She didn't intentionally do it. But
I
you
don't
can't
care
blame
anyone
Sigourney
says. Or
even
everything.
If no one dies, she's smashed up a lot of cars. Like, how would you even claim that in insurance? Okay, an octopus was driving a truck. Act of God?
See, she'll forget. She'll just be like, oh, I don't even remember doing that. And then she'll get away scot-free.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen.
Yep, see, for me,
It's just
for me, when Dory finds her parents, I was ready for the credits. I was like, okay, good. Oh god, now we're going again.
So really, that drew me back into the movie. Like that movie, like if there was any point where I felt like the movie was dragging on a bit, I feel like maybe it was right before she finds her parents, and then like when she finds the shell and it leads back to her home and she gets her parents back. That scene to me is so
whoa. Spoiler warning.
Oh. Sorry, my bad.
It's been long enough now. It's fine.
Not in the UK. Think of the Brits.
Yeah.
We've been through enough. Think
of the Brits.
Oh, man. I certainly did it.
I think the best thing about finding Dory, though, I think it's just how well they explore this aquarium environment and all of the fish that are in there. Like, I love the octopus. I think he's a really funny character, and Ed O'Neill's terrific. Just, I guess he's so cranky. He's lost a tentacle and he hates kids. And I think while it's a complete ripoff of the daycare scene in Toy Story 3, when they're in the touch tank. And it's like Saving Private Ryan, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, and how traumatic it is. And I think, like, because Idris Elba plays a sea lion, and those two sea lions, like, it's so funny. Oi, 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 oi! Get off!
Oh, my God. Yes.
That was great, yeah.
Like, it's funny, because how often this movie talks about helping the mentally disabled and whatnot, and then you get this... You get this really funny-looking seal wanting to get on this rock, and everyone all just laughing at him being yelled off. Oh my god, that's really funny.
And you get that bird, Becky. Like, which eye should I look at? It is really funny. I even like Destiny and Bailey. The shark and the whale who are nearby. They act as comic relief, but they're really endearing, and I enjoyed them a lot. I think it's just the climax is a bit overdrawn, and it's hard to just recapture finding Nemo, because it took them an entire movie to get across the ocean and finding Nemo, and then in finding Dory, they're across the ocean in like the first 10-15 minutes.
But would you have wanted them to spend a whole movie trying to cross the ocean?
I didn't want that, but it's just demonstrative of making a sequel to Finding Nemo. It's just an inherent issue that is going to happen no matter what you do with the sequel. I'm not saying that it would have been better if they had just repeated the first one, but it's like you do lose that sense of wonder in a sense. And Finding Dory is not trying to go for that, but I think Finding Nemo is just inherently just more set up for success. If that makes sense. Like, not all films are created equal, if that makes sense.
Well, Finding Nemo had that sense of the world. You know, you're being introduced into this world again, or for the first time, and you're being shown how beautiful the ocean can be. And at the crux of it is this really heartwarming, really, really, in many ways, very depressing story of this father trying to hold on to essentially the last memory of his wife, because his wife named it Nemo. His wife was the one that named the kids Nemo. And so you're trying to watch him trying. You're watching this father desperately try to rekindle the last little bit of happiness he has in his life after losing the love of after losing 50 kids and his wife. You know, so there's not that soul crushingly upsetting, sad story at the beginning that the Finding Nemo had. But Finding Dory, you're more watching Dory try to live her life with this very crippling disability. And I think there are certain scenes that I guess I'll stop using spoilers, but there are certain scenes that are, you know, at the start and at the end that are very, that I think at some points can reach that soul crushing Pixar crying thing that they love to do with their movies.
I think they do add to the Finding Nemo mythology, for lack of a better word, by showing what Dory was doing before she bumped into Marlin.
Yeah.
And I think that does add a lot to the character, and it does justify making a movie based off the comic relief from the first film. I do really like the film. I think it's great, and it's one of the better animated films I've seen this year. I just think that it's Finding Nemo was just lightning in a bottle, and they didn't try to recapture it. And it's good that they didn't deliberately try and ape the first one. I just think that the first one is more... its foundations are more solid and more prone to succeed. But I will say that the shorts that played before the film, Piper, the one with the bird. That was like
seeds,
you could pause any frame of that film and think it's a photograph.
It's really great. Like you may not love Good Dinosaur, but if you go back and watch Good Dinosaur, just watch scenes of just like water going through the grass. I turned to my friend Christian. I said, "Why are are they CG in the dinosaurs? They didn't. That's not real. That's real grass." Oh man,
Finding Dory, probably the greatest Sigourney Weaver performance in a long time.
Oh yeah.
Hello, I am Sigourney Weaver.
Hi, Sigourney.
Welcome to the aquarium.
Oh man, I don't look at this as a sequel to Finding Nemo as much as I do just kind of Dory's take on the whole adventure. This very much feels more like an appendage and not necessarily a separate sequel story. This feels more like a side story than a sequel itself, which I really liked. I liked how they did try to ape on the first one.
I was going to say, Trilby, what would you give it out of 10?
Probably an 8. I think it's when compared to like Pixar sequels, it's better than Cars 2. It's not quite Toy Story levels. But it's not just some soulless cash grab here. There's a lot of heart to the film. I think Ellen DeGeneres is terrific, and what people have been saying about this being a great movie for, like, I'm sure parents of disabled children will really embrace and find some extra layers to. I think that's absolutely correct. I just wish that we'd gotten to know the parents more in the movie. If that makes sense.
Fair enough.
I wish we got to know them a bit better. But
this makes me very excited for Toy Story 4, which I think they announced last year with the in terms of like with the plot and everything of how Woody and Buzz are going off to go find Bo Peep. I think this makes me really excited because Andrew Stanton, who is the writer director of this movie, I think he's writing Toy Story 4. And then John Lasseter's directing it. I'm really pumped for Toy Story 4 when that comes out.
Toy Story 4 is written by Rashida Jones, who does Parks and Recreations, Will McCormick, who, does Parks and Recreations.
Oh, dude. Well, it's going to be a funny movie then. I do Parks and Rec. Yeah. It is based off an idea.
Yeah, John Lasseter's doing Toy Story 4.
Yes, but I did read that it is based off an idea that Stanton came to John Lasseter with, that Andrew Stanton had come up with. But I'm really excited for Toy Story 4 if I've seen Finding Dory.
So yeah, the next Pixar film is Cars 3.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
comes out June 2017.
Bingo.
They're making a third one? Why?
Yeah, well, because the first one made $10 billion in merchandise, that's why.
But no
one
saw the second
one. The films themselves don't make that much money, but the merchandising, and I'm told that the Disneyland Cars ride is really, really good. It's basically merchandising, but if they have to make a few Cars films to get the budget to make some more original films, like they're making that Day of the Dead film next year as well, Coco,
yes.
I think it's called.
Yes.
And if doing cash grab Cars films allows them to do films like that, then we'll take that bullet.
I'll take a Cars 3 for an Inside Out any day of the week. So
that's right. The glass is half full. That's a good way of looking at it.
Yes, and the Cars
I'm not
films,
seeing it.
They're not even that terrible. Not even that bad. I kind of like them.
You're
obviously they're Pixar. Obviously they're Pixar off days, but Pixar on their off days
obviously
still better than most studios.
They are terrible movies with no. I completely disagree. I hate those movies.
Hey, I'm not going to risk my life for the Cars films, but
should we get carried away. Should we move on to listener questions?
Yes, we should move on to listener questions. We're just having a conversation now. All right, listener questions.
Because I don't know if our listeners would care about a conversation about Cars 3.
No, they absolutely
would. The only person who would care would be John Lasseter. Right. He's the only person who cares.
And if you listen to the show, thank you, please.
Thanks, John.
Just continue to listen.
I like Toy Story.
Excuse me. I'd like to ask you a few questions.
All right, guys. This is your listener question portion of the show, in which case, on Facebook, Twitter, and whatnot, we ask for your guys' listener questions, in which case we read them on the show. So, starting here, Seb Petey, a friend of the show here, Seb Petey asks, if the cinematic genie appeared to you, what would your three cinematic wishes be?
Right. Are we going by Aladdin genie rules, where we can't make people fall in love, we can't bring anyone back from the dead,
and we can't wish for more wishes? Let's make that a rule now.
Yeah.
I'd wish for the death of found footage.
You'd wish for what?
Sorry? I'd wish for the death of found footage.
The death of found footage.
All right.
Just killing the genre.
Yep.
All right.
Not worth it. Actually, I think I'm done there. Who wants my other two wishes, folks?
Well, I would kill all diversity in cinema. No.
Bandit kills all black ladies for the Rocketeer.
No, I think. Oh, gee, that's a tough.
The reason why will surprise you. I'm just trying to imagine the clickbait headline.
Since you guys have wasted one of your wishes on being a comedian, I'll go ahead and start here. Yeah. Obviously, I think I have to use one of my wishes to. Let me go back and rewatch The Dark Knight on a 70mm IMAX screen, like I did when I was 8. So let that be a thing again, please, so I can experience that again. My second cinematic wish is to let me direct an episode of the Star Wars movies. And my third is for me to win an Oscar.
Hey, I've got my second wish. Movies where... with talking animals that shouldn't be talking, I wish for them to never get theatrical releases. We've got 9 Lives coming out next week. I don't want to watch that. Oh,
live action. Okay. I'm like, wait.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's
Kevin Spacey's a talking cat. Nope. Yeah. Don't want that. I don't want that crowding up my
doing the same role from Chris Rock and doing the same role from Click that I haven't seen a movie from 10 years ago. Wow. Okay.
I would wish for a crossover between Avengers and Justice League.
Oh yes. No.
I
want to
see Superman fighting the Hulk.
I was going to
see Batman and Tony Stark. Yeah, talking billionaire talk.
Let me get Superman fight the Hulk. Not Superman. Let me get Wolverine to fight the Hulk. That's my sentiment. I've been wanting that since I was like 4. Please, yeah. That's very possible.
I'm sure that could probably happen.
Please. Oh my God. I would. Don't put it in the trailer though. Otherwise, it'll be spoiled for me.
You know what Marvel could do if they can't get the rights to Wolverine? They could just like take another character and make him like discount Wolverine.
It's not the same. It's not the same. It's got to be Wolverine.
It's not the same. Banshee or something? No, there already is.
You're a big fat phony. You're not the same.
As much as you're going to kill me for saying this, Trilby, but I would like to see The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly remake.
Is that like your favorite movie?
Yes.
Here's the funny thing, Bandit. When you were talking about Sony's the worst thing ever and they do terrible remakes, I'm looking forward to Magnificent Seven.
Yeah.
That's a Sony film.
It's because it's kind of like...
It is a Sony film, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that reminds me, actually. Yes, there's... Yeah,
well, like what you like.
Trilby, there's a question here from a guy called B Inc., who says, Hey, Trilby, how do you feel about Sony posting a $100 million deficit this quarter and being expected to fire a lot of people from the company because Ghostbusters tanked so bad? Ha ha ha, you suck, Trilby. P.S. Bandit is awesome. That's from B Inc. Thank you, B Inc. I think you have
first
a
really of all,
good
all right, first of all, B Inc.
I still have one movie wish left. Do not tempt me. I have power. actually, my third wish before we move on is I wish that movie scripts were much more easily accessible to read.
Oh yeah,
there are some places where you can read a couple of them in libraries, but I just wish there was an awesome massive database where I don't know you pay $5 and you get a ebook version of a movie script, because that would be terrific
for movies that aren't out yet, like ones that have yet to
No, ones that have been released, like when they come out on DVD, you can also you buy the Blu-ray and you get the digital copy of the film and you get a script. I don't know, something like that.
That'd be cool.
So to answer B-Ink's question is...
Yeah, to answer B-Ink's question... To answer B-Ink's question, who I'm sure is a very handsome piece of work,
that's totally not something I made up.
Yeah.
Just saying.
It's absolutely... it sucks when people get fired and people lose their jobs. That always sucks. Filmmaking is depressingly a business. Some great films don't sometimes bomb at the box office. Some bad films make loads of money at the box office. People were saying, oh, Ghostbusters, it's not opening in China because it's terrible. Transformers 4 opened in China, and it made like $1 billion there.
Yeah, Terminator Genesis opened in China. Yes, yeah,
exactly.
Ghostbusters get kicked out of China because it was terrible. Got kicked out of China because they're superstitious and they don't like ghosts.
I think there's some sexism in that China thing, though. That might just be me, but whatever. That's just my weird conspiracy brain going at.
Well, way to generalize the entire country, Trey.
Sue me.
I can't believe, be the first Trey, time, that you're saying something about China that's negative.
Oh my God, so right? Heresy. Coming from a Chinese man myself. Okay, so let's give another question.
Speaking about like money and all that stuff and diversity in film and all that, I have actually heard there's a stock trading strategy going around called the dollar diversity dilemma, which is you bet against any company that enforces a diversity quota. And apparently it works. It's called the dollar diversity. Like if a company announces, we're going to enforce a diversity quota, people bet against it because the companies always go down. Because if you're hiring people to fill a quota rather than who's best for the job, the company always starts to go downhill, so you bet against it, and people are making a lot of money on that. So, to fit in with, like,
I need to see the numbers thing for that.
Did you find this during your movie stock investing that you've been doing a lot? You said you've been investing in trying to look in the movie stock trade. Did you just find that while you're looking around?
But that's why it'll be interesting to see what happens with the Black Lady Rocketeer.
Oh man, I gotta see your wall banded of just these things that you just find. You just, it's like I Trilby, have you seen The Big Short? I think I brought this up on the show before.
Oh yeah, I love The Big Short.
You guys need Bandy. You need to watch The Big Short because what you just told me sounds a very Big Short esque. I just watched it like a couple weeks ago. It's a great movie.
Just getting away from movies for a moment. The comic book industry, Marvel, have been making a killing financially because they've made the Hulk Chinese, or they've got a black young lady Iron Man, and they've got a black Captain America, and they've been doing this diversity in the comics, and of course you've got Kamala Khan, who is Miss Marvel, who's a Pakistani teenager, and they've been raking in the cash. I'm not saying they're making billions of dollars. It's the comic book industry. It's not what it used to be, but they're outselling DC. They're making a lot of money in the comic industry because they've been embracing diversity. So it'd be interesting to know what other industries are like that. And there's the, when I watched the Michael Moore documentary, Where to Invade Next, he went to, was it Iceland? Where they're one of the few countries who managed to get out of the economic recession because they had a gender quota where it had to be either 40% male or 40% female at least. It couldn't just be skewed to one gender. Like, you needed to have at least 40% men or at least 40% women. And their economy has just been skyrocketing ever since.
Which country is this?
Iceland,
I think it's Iceland.
It's one of those Scandinavian areas.
I think it's a smaller country, but it managed to get out of one of the first countries to get out of the recession because it had a gender quota, and it was an equal gender quota. It wasn't just 100% women. Let's all fix the country. It wasn't anything like that. But it's the we can do it. It's the we can do it poster. But yeah. I don't know. Let's get a ice lady there. I don't know. That's what Iceland's like, right?
An ice woman.
If you have, if you have a society where men and women work as opposed to just men, then you've doubled your workforce. So of course you're gonna generate more money. Yeah, absolutely.
But if it is
oddly skeptical from you, Ben, then I'm just saying you can keep going.
I heard Australia was actually the country that navigated the economic crisis the best, so I'm a little bit upset at Iceland now. Damn you!
If it wasn't Germany,
you gave us the mountain, I'd be really angry at you. But
there's also Germany, who was the only country during the recession to have a female prime minister or female president, and they did incredibly well as well.
Oh, is that
America might get a female president soon, but we all know how that's going to turn out. So
yeah.
That's not a good
idea. It could be worse.
Yeah, great.
I mean, it's either Hillary or Trump at this point, which is either or. It's not the best, but
yeah, it's going to be Trump. Trump's going to win.
Yeah.
Sorry, I wish I hadn't used all of my movie wishes now, and I wish I could get Trump. Man. Oh, I didn't. With great power comes great responsibility.
Yeah, man. If only we could build that wall around that tower of his. Okay, which one? All right. So we have another. Let's say,
I got another question here on Twitter from Miss.
I'll build a wall around Nine Lives. That's what I'll do. That movie.
I got a question here on Twitter. Well, it's not so much a question, but since we don't focus on Twitter, I want to read some of these. Cutie Patootie says, Movie Mania, you guys didn't discuss the reveal of the Black Panther cast at Comic-Con. And she's put up a picture of Eddie Murphy from The Nutty Professor screaming, why?
Because it wasn't that interesting.
Okay. That's right, obviously.
Speaking as the black man of the pod, black quote unquote man, I'm 16 years old. Speaking as the black man of the podcast, the reason, because I'm the one that always assembles what the news is we're talking about on the show. And so when I was cherry picking the Comic-Con news from last week, I decided, what should we talk about? Should we talk about Brie Larson as Captain Marvel? Kinda. Should we talk about the Black Panther cast? Kinda. But if we didn't get a lot, but I think. The only thing I was upset that I missed out on was the Thor Ragnarok stuff, because some stuff came out from Thor Ragnarok that I forgot to talk about because I was really wanting to talk about it. For example, they're confirming Planet Hulk is a thing because they showed schematics and stuff of the Planet Hulk armor and whatnot. So that was kind of cool. Yeah. But we didn't talk about the Black Panther.
Thor Ragnarok is going to be a disguised Planet Hulk because they're not allowed to do a straight up Hulk movie, so they're turning Thor into Hulk. But we're supposed to be talking about Black Panther panel.
I think one thing we talked about Comic-Con last week was that we mainly talked about the trailers and the more visual stuff that everyone was talking about. I think we wanted to be more broad and more mainstream, for lack of a better word, as opposed to some of the stuff at the panels.
But the Black Panther panel, I'm sure, was great. And I think there was, like, the director, Ryan Coogler, who did Creed and Fruitvale Station, he said that he, back in 2009 or 2010, that he was at Comic-Con sitting in the crowd. So to be on stage was a great moment for him, which is great and all. But if you don't show us anything and we're not there at the panel, we're not just going to sit there and talk about the panel. But I do think it was cool that – was it announced that Michonne from The Walking Dead was added to the cast? If it was, I didn't know about it. So, but they just announced – I'm not sure when they announced that, but that's a thing now. So that's kind of cool. Hopefully they'll get
announced that. And we got Lupita Nyong'o, Michael B. Jordan. Yeah.
Great cast. And it's an all-black cast from what we know. I think I'm not counting.
Plus Andy Serkis.
Yeah. And so I'm sure it's going to be a fantastic film, but it hasn't come out for another, 2 years? So, you know. Yeah. Miss Cootie Patootie, there you go. All right. all right. I have a question here on Facebook. AJ, oh my God, McOwen. I think that's how you say that.
I love how your voice drops. Like, AJ, oh no.
McOwen, you turned into Batman for a minute, you know?
Life doesn't give you last names.
Why'd you say that name? He said, if you guys could be the masterminds behind the DC cinematic universe, how would you do it starting from scratch? He said, you know, so how would the movie lineup work? Which directors would you choose? So on and so forth.
So I won't say anything because I've already done videos all about this. So.
Okay. What about you, Chili?
I like what the idea of what they did, and that we open with a Superman movie and how that instantly brings aliens and cosmic elements into the universe, and how he is like the first superhero, depending on how you look at it, he's the first one to get a film, and then he sort of jumpstarts everything. I like that idea of a first contact Superman movie, and he kickstarts everything, and then I kind of like what DC are doing. I just wish they were better at it.
Yeah, I'm okay with Zack Snyder directing Man of Steel because I really like Man of Steel. I really enjoy that movie. So maybe you keep Man of Steel. And I think, Bandy, you've talked about this a long time ago back on like the old Movie Mania podcast that you used to do. You talked about how if you would do a Man of Steel back when I was just listening to your stuff while walking to school, you would talk about how you do like a Man of Steel sequel, and you would use the sequels to introduce other characters, and then spin them up, kind of like what they're doing on TV, where they'll introduce characters in like Arrow, and then they'll get their own spinoff show. Maybe, and like you said, because since they were gonna have Batman in the sequel before it was announced to be Batman versus Superman, and I think That way you can do, you put Wonder Woman in a movie and then you have her do her own thing, which is what they're kind of doing. But I would not have Zack Snyder direct the sequel solely because they clearly gave him too much power in this one. He clearly Tim Burtoned this one up in the sense of that he was reserved in the last movie with all with, you know, with the lack of slow motion, but there was still a lot of action in it. So that when he got to this one, he just went balls to the walls Zack Snyder on it. And so maybe I don't know who he would get to do it. Maybe first of all, don't make it Batman versus Superman. Maybe just make it a Batman Superman movie, and then you get to, I don't know, someone like Doug Liman to do it, who did Edge of Tomorrow. I think he'd do a good job doing a superhero movie, and then that way you introduce other characters through other movies, and you build to Justice League. I'm not worried about them being behind Marvel. I don't care that we would get Justice League 1 by the time Infinity War comes out, because that way you're at least building to the universe, and we not have an investment in all these characters by the time they all come together on screen. That's how I would do it.
Yeah, like, I like the idea of having Superman show up and then a Batman comes out of retirement. I just think that a Batman v Superman movie should have been years down the line. Like that should have been a subplot as part of a Justice League movie. It should have amounted to like the Hulk versus Hulkbuster fight in Age of Ultron. It should have been a long scene in a collaborative movie, if that makes sense. As opposed to like what's meant to be the driving force of a story. But like I said, I like what they're doing in terms of let's get Justice League together and then we'll do these standalone films. And Flash and Cyborg are going to be a buddy cop type movie. I like those ideas. I just wish they were implementing them better. But hopefully once Suicide Squad comes out next week, we'll know if the problem is with the whole inception of the DC cinematic universe, or if it's just Zack Snyder. Because if David Ayer and Patty Jenkins with Wonder Woman can't make a good movie come together, then there's clearly more wrong here than just Zack Snyder. That's my point.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult, isn't it? Because I think Nick Mundy on Screen Junkies said it best in one of his rants, where he said, you know what would have easily have been better than the Avengers? The Justice League. And he's right. Like, if they had gotten in first, they would have just easily have been better. But now that Marvel's kind of done it the way that they did, it's really difficult for DC to, like, either they're following, like, following the same pattern that Marvel did, or they're trying to do it all at once like they're doing now, and it doesn't quite work. So they're really, they're damned if they do and they're damned if they don't now. And that's, but it's their own fault. Like, they had the rights all along. They should have done this ages ago. You know?
Like Nick Mundy said when he was like, "We're getting a movie with a talking tree and a with a talking raccoon and a tree, and we can't even get bloody Wonder Woman." Yeah, I love that. I was like, "That's so true." But you know, it's whoever. But it was always going to be whoever gets in first, because I think the problem is that by the time Nolan's trilogy was done, we were already at the Avengers. You know, you know what I'm saying, like. It was the placement was odd that, you know, that Superman Returns, I think that was going to be something. I feel like they were going to try to cross that over with something. I forget what it was, but that was their attempt. And like Joss Whedon, you know, the Avengers is Joss Whedon, wrote a Wonder Woman script and brought it to DC, and they laughed at his face and they said, you're never going to do a superhero movie. And then he ended up making two of the biggest movies of all time, by finances wise, with the Avengers movies. So I feel like it was just bad decisions and bad timing on their part, because
They tried with Green Lantern in 2011, which they put over $200 million in that film. They brought it to Comic-Con, had so much marketing and everything, and they were hoping to spin that off into sequels in a cinematic universe. That they had Amanda Waller in that film, who's played by Viola Davis in Suicide Squad. I forget who played her in Green Lantern.
That movie, but she was. It really followed the Iron Man formula too. It had all the. It had, like, Ryan Reynolds being the funny guy. It's like, yeah, you could see they really wanted that to be a jumping-off point. Maybe they should have just went with that, you know? I don't know.
Maybe, but then the movie just absolutely bombed at the box office and lost Warner Brothers, like, $100 million.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why they didn't keep going with it, because
they've had two more
false starts. Everyone hated that movie. You know? Yeah, would you call Man of Steel a false start?
Yeah, because it demanded
financially,
audiences.
It wasn't.
Yeah,
financially,
yeah,
it wasn't.
Not financially, but Batman v Superman financially was. So
yes,
but I think that if after Green Lantern and then they do Man of Steel and it's they say no, we'll start again. I think after Green Lantern, like Man of Steel had to be the all or nothing. This is the start. We're going regardless. Yeah, otherwise, yeah, they just look terrible in comparison to Marvel and Disney.
But see, now they're doing Justice League, and Justice League is sort of like, again, them trying to start. And this is like the fourth time now. You know, that Green Lantern, Man of Steel, Batman v Superman. Now, hopefully, they'll get it right with this.
Yeah, that's true. This feels like their second. This feels like a second soft reboot Justice League in a sense, because Batman and Superman, they all feel like different movies.
See, Batman
and how
v
they
Superman should have been the damage control for Man of Steel. They ignored it and pushed ahead. Now they're having to do damage control for the damage control of the damage control. And it's just, God, it's a mess. But look, this is why, like, the only thing I will say is, like, again, on my channel, I talked about, don't do Darkseid because he's just like Thanos and people will think you're ripping off Marvel because they're going to do Thanos, even though Thanos in the comics is actually a ripoff of Darkseid. That's why I was like, do something else. Like, you could do something like in DC, like, you got to get ahead of Marvel in some way. So get ahead in story. Do something like Parallax. Parallax is a really cool... Sorry,
they
Parallax
can't do
is
that.
This giant celestial...
Poop cloud.
Giant celestial entity who basically wants to restart the Big Bang, wipe out all life and start it again. Not because he's a bad guy, it's just he's a force of nature. That's what he does. So all the good
they
guys
can't do that.
The
they already
guys.
Did Parallax.
Oh,
he's a poop cloud in Green Lantern.
That doesn't count.
But that's what. But that's what people. But that's what people think Parallax is. They'll be like, "Oh, that thing
nobody
from Green Lantern." So is this?
That,
is that
nobody
this
cares. Year? It doesn't matter.
To be fair, Justice League is going to have Steppenwolf as the villain, as opposed to Darkseid. So he's not going to be there straight away.
Yeah, he's going to be the underling, like, leading an army from Darkseid. Just how Loki was the underling for Thanos, leading an army. And you need them to have a fight, probably in New York or Metropolis. It's just Avengers again.
But what they could do with Darkseid is
do something else. If you do Parallax, you could have Lex Luthor and Superman working together. Do something new. Go forward in the storyline. Get ahead of Marvel. Stop following them.
Here's an idea, though. What's great about having, I really want Warner Brothers to succeed with their cinematic universe, because then it will cause Marvel to, like, try harder to compete more, and then we'll get two awesome cinematic universes competing with each other. And then what will happen is that Thanos comes along in the movies, he could be awesome or whatever, and then Darkseid comes along and they say, okay, what do people not like about Thanos? What do people not like about this and that? And then they implement that feedback into Darkseid and they make an awesome epic villain. But the issue with having Darkseid is, like, it's John Carter syndrome, where John Carter is this really influential book and series and everybody adapts everything from it, but then by the time it gets made into a big movie, everyone's like, oh, it's just a ripoff of everything, even though John Carter created everything.
Exactly.
Like, you're gonna have that problem no matter what. So if you it's like Deadpool is a ripoff of Deathstroke. It's going to happen no matter what.
Well, everybody wanted, like, for instead of before they announced Batman v Superman, everybody wanted Brainiac. Everyone said, we want another Superman movie with Brainiac this time and a Lex Luthor that's actually a villain instead of a bumbling idiot. That's what everyone said. And then they announced Batman v Superman. We're like, oh, okay.
We were like, all right, well, who are you going to get as Batman? And everyone's like, Ben Affleck. And I was like,
oh.
They're Ben Affleck. And I was just like, oh, okay, yeah, I was thinking. Everyone was just like, fire and blood. People were so mad.
Being,
I remember.
He is the least worst part of that movie. That's
you just don't want to say best. You don't want to say best, but that, but you, that's
yeah,
what he
well,
is.
There is nothing that you can call best in that movie, so he's the least worst thing in that movie.
I think the opening scene is a great scene, but that's neither here nor there. But anyways, we don't have time to go into all that. Because I don't feel like we already got Bandit started on his whole DC rant. Whenever he gets started on a DC rant, he can't stop himself.
They just need Yeah, like, in terms of how they construct their universe, obviously they're sort of always going to be behind Marvel in that because they're literally starting after Marvel. But that's why I think they should get ahead of them story-wise so they can start doing things that Marvel isn't doing yet. You know, that's why I suggest Parallax or get into, like, Injustice or The Syndicate or something like that. Just because, like, even Suicide Squad seems like it's modeling itself off Guardians of the Galaxy a lot more. So I mean,
I think it might just be the marketing campaign. I don't know that the movie's going to actually be like that. Yeah. From what I've heard, the movie is not going to be very... I feel like that's just how DC's marketing the movie.
Yeah, but I mean, we can predict. But that means, like, you know, it's... Like, if they're doing Thor as, like, a Planet Hulk movie, then we could probably predict that, I don't know, Aquaman is probably going to have something very similar, you know?
I don't know, the DC version
of Planet Hulk or something.
Here's a hypothetical, because Deadpool came out and it outgrossed X-Men Apocalypse by a wide margin, even though it cost a fraction of what that did to make. So clearly Fox is going to move on with a lot of cheaper Deadpool-esque movies. What happens if Suicide Squad comes out, makes $1 billion, outgrosses Man of Steel, outgrosses Batman v Superman?
I think it will. I think it will.
I'm worried they're going to give David Ayer too much control in the universe.
Where does that? But where would that leave like the rest of like the future Warner Brothers movies? Would they just cancel Aquaman and make a Harley Quinn movie? Would they cancel Cyborg and make Enchantress?
They'll turn around and say, "This means we need to have Batman in everything." That's what they'll
do. Because Batman's in this movie, they're going to be like, oh, well, they just love Batman because they love Batman, Batman, and Superman, and they loved him in the Justice League trailer. Then Suicide Squad made $1 billion. Yeah. Give me 3 Batman movies, Batman trilogy.
But see, people are interested in it because it's creative and new and it's very comic booky. It happens.
It feels fun when watching the trailers, whereas Batman v Superman didn't come across as fun.
Well, Batman and Superman had, when the trailers, at least for the first 2 trailers, I think, especially that Comic-Con trailer, it had the sense of, like, epic scale to it. And when I saw the trailers, I was like, this looks really intense, and I was really excited. But that's all it was. It was like Jason Bourne, just intense the whole way through, and it didn't have any kind of... Levity is very important to have in movies. Even some of the darkest movies out there, like your Gone Girls, your Dark Knight, those are some dark movies, but they have moments of levity, and then that make them stand out and make them balance.
Instead of just, is she with you?
I thought she was with you.
That's not levity.
No, because of course she's with you, Batman, because you sent her the email.
Yeah, you just sent her the email. You know that.
Okay. Final question.
Well, actually, trailer,
Batman, why are you forgetting your own movie?
Martha. Okay, I've got a couple of questions here. Okay. So wrong one. Ben, oh man, these names. Ben Guilfoyle. I'm so sorry, Mr. Ben.
Why did you say that name?
It's his mother's name. Her maiden name. Okay. Have you heard about the Netflix adaptation of A Series of Unfortunate Events, and are you looking forward to watching it? Do you guys know what that is? A Series of Unfortunate Events?
I know what it is. Yes, I saw the movie, but I hadn't heard about this.
This book series, Ben, you've seen the movie, so you know at least you need to know some of the context.
Sure,
for those of you guys that don't, it tells the story of 3 orphans who, you know, after the tragic death of their parents, go on these very Tim Burton-esque adventures that eventually lead to them trying to solve the mystery. First, it's about them going to different companions and different guardians, of them trying to raise them, and of course, with things always somehow going bad, things always going very unfortunate for these kids, which eventually will then lead to them trying to figure out what happens to their parents. And in my opinion, it's a very fantastic series of books. If it wasn't for Harry Potter, it'd probably be my favorite book series that I have out there. Like, I think, like, book 12 in that series for me, I think, is incredible. That's the one about the giant hotel, if you guys know what I'm talking about. But so I think they announced that they were doing this Netflix series a while back. I think they announced it. And I think there was, like, this short fan-made teaser that went around on YouTube that looks really cool. I'm really excited whenever they do finally make it, because Netflix is doing some great things. Speaking of things, Stranger Things, I haven't seen it yet. Please don't spoil it for me if you guys have. What do you think about that, Chobi? Since you read the books.
I think it's really exciting. I love Neil Patrick Harris as Count Olaf. I think that's a really inspired, outside-the-box choice that just makes more sense the more you think about it.
Yeah.
Has that been announced?
That's been announced. We've seen pictures of him on set.
Oh, my God. I gotta
seriously.
Look this up right now.
Google Neil Patrick Harris, Count Olaf, and there's pictures of him in the makeup and the hair. And yeah, it looks like he came straight out of the book covers. And we've got Patrick Warburton voicing the author, Lemony Snicket, because That is a really interesting choice.
Because I always pictured a voice like Jude Law in the movie, but...
Someone really
weird.
Sly.
It was weird, he was narrating it, but he wasn't even in the movie.
Yeah. I think having Netflix adapt it, something that's, it's mainstream, but it can act like it's outside of the mainstream and do these quirky out of the box experimental things. I think that's a great format for this series. And there's like 13 books and they're going to be making 8 episodes of this series. So I'm wondering how far they go. Do they do what the movie did and adapt the first three books in one go, or do they
just cut out a couple of the books.
Maybe.
Because I think it's book 4 where they go to like the steel mill or the wooden mill, that you can cut out book 4 like that.
Yeah.
Some of the shorter ones.
If there's one criticism to be leveled at the books, it's that all of them, I can't remember what happens nearer the end, but like the first 6 or 7 books are basically the three kids, they go to this place, though the meet a relative is really nice, and then, oh, it turns out that Count Olaf's there in disguise, and no one believes them, even though this has happened all the time, and then they have to uncover
someone
the plan.
Someone ends up dying, yeah.
Yeah, you really, if you want that to work and have audiences tune in week by week, you gotta trim that down. You've got to mix up the structure. It's like, I cannot marathon episodes of the A-Team. I love the A-Team,
yeah.
But you cannot marathon it because every episode it hits the same beats, hits the same points, hits the same notes. You can't marathon it. You've got to watch an episode a week if you want to enjoy the A-Team.
I think you're onto something there, but I think if they focus more on the mystery aspect of it, that kind of gets started up again in the second half of the series. Because you're right, that first 6 or 7 books, I think it's book 7 where things kind of, I can't remember if it was a book, because they do meld together if you're not careful. I think it's book 7 where they go to like this village and they start discovering what things are about and what happened with their parents. And I think if you focus on that.
It's after the 7th one, the Vile Village, where they can't, they're no longer allowed to have any guardians and they're kind of going about it alone.
Yeah. Here's my thing, because you've read the book series. Do you, if you were the creators, do you keep the ending as ambiguous as the books do?
I think so. I think Netflix, you can get away with that. Like, if it was
they
TV,
answered nothing. There's nothing answered by the time the book is over. Pretty much.
What's probably going to happen with Netflix is that they'll put all of the episodes on at once and then you can marathon them. Whereas if you did that for TV, people have been waiting for this conclusion for weeks, for months. Yeah. And then it's ambiguous and the ending is a big anticlimax. Like, you can kind of get away with that for books, because to get to the end you need a certain amount of patience anyway. That's inherent with books. Whereas with TV, something more mainstream and accessible, you wouldn't get away with it. But for Netflix, if you marathon it all at once, it's not nearly as bad. It depends on how they play it.
My theory is that Lemony Snicket is actually their father. That's just my theory, but that's neither here nor there. That's something I came up with when I read it when I was little. I was like, is Lemony Snicket their father? But anyways, that you guys have no idea what that means if you haven't read the book series. But do check out the books themselves, or even check out the movie. It's got Meryl Streep in it. I think what's his face? I think Timothy Spall is in it. Bloody Wormtail from Harry Potter. He's in it. Yeah, that's a pretty. Yeah.
And Jim Carrey is a lot of fun as Count Olaf. And it's not anything from the books at all, but one of the funniest scenes is when he's with his acting troupe, who are just terrible. And they're like, oh, we go back to prehistoric times when dinosaurs ruled the earth. And Jim Carrey as Count Olaf is doing a T-Rex impression with the arms and he's chomping. Really, I think that's really funny.
The series does go as darker with the tone of the books as it does, because the books do get rather dark. There's still a sense of silliness to it, because it's like a Tim Burton universe-esque in the production design and whatnot. But I'm really excited to see how, because I just saw the picture of Neil Patrick Harris and he looks great.
Do watch the film, because I do think it really does hold up and it is a lot of fun. And it also won an Oscar for best makeup. And me and my girlfriend met the makeup artist, Bill Corso, and he flirted with my girlfriend, the dick. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. That's Trey says.
He's got him in his basement. Oh, well, that's another guy.
Question here on Twitter.
I was wondering who was in the basement. I thought it was you, Trey.
Question here on question here on Twitter from Catface Meowers says,
great name.
What was the most disappointing movie this year so far? So not bad movie, like not a movie that you knew would suck and it did, but one that you were hoping would be really good and left you disappointed. Might be Finding Dory for you, Trey. For me, obviously, it's Batman v Superman.
Wait, why would it be Finding Dory for me? I love that movie. I think we already talked about that. Yeah? What do you want about?
Sorry, I'm confused. That's right. Finding Nemo is the one you didn't like.
I like Finding Nemo. I really like Finding Nemo. This is going to go somewhere. But you're right.
I'd go with Batman v Superman, although Jason Bourne was disappointing too. I wasn't as invested as I was with Batman v Superman. So what are you guys what's your disappointing ones?
I'm going to go Jungle Book. Because leading into Batman v Superman, I was so trepidatious because I had heard nothing but truly awful things, and so my expectations were very tempered going into it. Granted, that opening scene really set my expectations high again, but I was still in the back of my head waiting for something to go bad, and which it did. But Jungle Book, I was waiting for the movie to reach that next level of incredible that I had heard across the board, and it never did. So maybe that's more against everyone else hyping up the film and instead of me just going to the film blind. But I was waiting for Jungle Book to reach that level of, oh man, this movie is one of the best of the year. And it's good. I didn't say it's not terrible. It's good. It's like a 7. I think I gave like a 7.5. It's good. It's just not, it doesn't reach that next step for me that I think everyone else, for it did for everyone else. So yeah, Jungle Book.
I'm just thinking of every, because I did like a top 10 most anticipated list at the beginning of the year. Like Batman v Superman, obviously. There's also X-Men Apocalypse, which, because I love Days of Future Past and I got really excited by the trailers and was really let down by it.
Killing Joke. Killing Joke.
For a smaller film, I'm thinking maybe Green Room. Because I'd heard such great things about it, and it sounded like something that was really up my alley, and I got really hyped for it. And Patrick Stewart as a neo-Nazi villain, that sounds awesome. And then the movie comes out, I watch it, and it's But now I'm obligated to like it because Anton Yelchin died shortly after it came out, so now I have to like it. Bloody hell. Bloody SJWs making me like movies.
You just have to like him in it, is all. Otherwise, people are going to start judging you.
You can blame SJWs for anything, and it makes sense. that's what I'm thinking. Like, one of the biggest surprises, I know that's not what we were asked, but probably Zootropolis, because the trailers were awful, at least I thought they were. And then it comes out, and it's actually really intelligent and really original and really funny.
If we're going surprises, I'm going to go 10 Cloverfield Lane. Just because I wasn't expecting that movie to be as intense and really just heart-pounding as it was. Because it really is just three people in a room for 90 minutes. And they really... And that's not giving anything
away. Like this podcast.
Okay. Yeah. It's a bottle podcast. Yeah. I was really impressed with 10 Cloverfield Lane, I think. And we talked about that on the podcast a while back. So, yeah. Anyways.
Well, hopefully next week we won't be saying that our most disappointing movie was Suicide Squad, because I'm really looking forward to it.
Oh, boy. Me too.
I think it's going to be great.
I'm pretty sure I'm seeing that.
It's going
to
be great.
I'm trying to go Thursday night, and hopefully I can get into that. So, yeah. Also, apparently Sausage Party is disappointing from the people that I've heard, even though it holds 100% of Rotten Tomatoes, but that's not the point there. Yeah. Okay.
Well, I guess Sausage Party, once you get the joke, there's not much else to it.
That's my concern, right? That's my concern.
It's like a movie with one
I saw this one thing about a jar of jelly, and like this, and like the peanut butter was like the husband, and the jelly was his wife, and he's got like the jelly in his hands. Oh man, it looks great. Okay, so... All right, I think that'll do it here, guys. So this has been an episode of the Movie Mania, a quote-unquote mini-sode of Movie Mania.
Which has gone for over 2 hours.
I called it at the start. I said this episode was going to go plus 2 hours.
It was good. We were able to cover a lot of, like, mop up a lot of different topics. So good.
You can find me online on my website, www.trilby.com. I'm currently making my way through the back catalog of films that I've yet to review, so you can find my reviews of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Out of the Shadows, Race, Independence Day Resurgence is going up tomorrow, And things like that. So yeah, you can go on my website, you can go on my Twitter, on my YouTube channel at Trilby Reviews. I do regular writing for the website geekfeed.com, so check out my stuff there. So, and you can find me on the Movie Mania podcast. Hooray! Be sure to subscribe to that on iTunes and such, and leave reviews.
Oh yes,
and be awesome.
Rate us on iTunes. Yes, thank you, Trilby. Yes, I always
steal your friend's phone and rate their iTunes.
Yes, get us up there. Rate us on iTunes. Bander, where can people find you?
People can find me on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter as Bandit Incorporated. And they can find you, Trey.
Yes, they can find me on right here on the podcast, of course, and on my YouTube channel, Podcast Media, my Instagram, Podcast Media, short film still in the works. Yeah. Okay, yes, rate us on
Thanks
iTunes.
Again to all our amazing artists and all you guys who supported and voted and got involved. Really fantastic.
Congratulations to Mr. Birchhill, was it his last name, for winning the contest. And well done everyone's designs. Catch you all next week when we talk Suicide Squad with Miss Alicia Malone. See you guys next week, our Movie Maniacs.